Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa.
Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa.
Homage to the blessed, noble, and perfectly enlightened one. Namo sarando sucedo ye olahuri samyao samputoshe.
Namo sarando sucedo ye olahuri samyao samputoshe.
Wushang shen shen wei miao fa bai qian wan jie nan zao yu. Wo jin jian wan de shou chi yan jie ru lai zhen shi yi. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in hundreds of thousands of millions of eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I bow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual meaning. Venerable Master, Dharma friends, welcome to our sutra lecture this evening. We're here in Berkeley, California. It is Saturday, December 16, no, 13, December 13. We're almost halfway through the month of December. We're investigating the Flower Garland Sutra, the Ten Grounds chapter. This is one piece of a very large Buddhist text. We're at the sixth ground. We're halfway through that sixth chapter, so we're going to just continue as we do, taking a sentence at a time, a word at a time sometimes, and moving on through the text. So, excuse me, in order to begin, I'm going to point you to the title of the text here in Chinese on the second half of your cover, bottom half. We're going to chant that name, and by doing that, we're invoking, we're calling in, honoring the beings who first put this text into the air. Historically, they would say this happened 2,500 years ago. So tonight, if we bring our minds to a single point of concentration, we could say this is the very first night the Avatamsaka Sutra was sounded. So it's not a old text, it's a perennial text. It's a completely eternal set of wisdom that we're invoking tonight. So please join me and let's chant along and invoke the Avatamsaka Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. Here we go.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fu Hua Yin Ji Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Na Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yen Jing Hua
yen hai hui po pu sa namo da fang guang fo hai yen jing huai yen hai hui po pu sa namo da fang guang fo hai yen jing Hua yin hai hui po pu sa na Da fang guang fu hua yin ji Hua yin hai hui po pu sa na Mo da fang guang fu hua yin ji Ayin hai hui po pu sa. So, welcome folks who are joining us from all around the planet, from wherever you might be. Some are in Taiwan tonight, some are in Florida tonight, some are in Australia this morning, and we're all coming together kind of like iron filings coming back to a magnet. Do you have a magnet in your house? Maybe your can opener has a magnet. Oh, refrigerator magnets. We have refrigerator magnets, right? So when I was a kid, magnets were like these raw bars of metal, and you kind of, if you were lucky, you had a workshop with nails in them. And you take that big chonky magnet and draw it in the nails, and go kung like that, and it would be so cool because there was power, invisible power in that piece of metal. So there's a tradition in our Buddhist line that says sutras, these texts, act like magnets. And they draw us back from however far it takes, however far we come. The sutra kong, draws us back to the text. And isn't that it? What a concept. You know, we think of a sutra as a book. Is that all it is? And if so, what power does a book have to attract people? But question, we should think about that. Certainly, personally, that's my story. I arrived at Gold Mountain Monastery in 1973. And when I got to the door of that converted mattress factory on 15th Street in the Mission District in San Francisco, there in the front window were four Chinese characters, which I could not read, I confess. I had to have somebody tell me. It said, Hua Yan Fa Hui, Flower Garland Dharma Gathering, Dharma Assembly. Avatamsaka Sutra being lectured here, that's what it said. And Master Hua, the teacher who, our founder, whose picture is here on the table, had just begun explaining the Flower Garland Sutra 2 weeks earlier when I showed up at Gold Mountain Monastery having driven across the Bay Bridge in my Volvo from my Berkeley commune where I was living as a graduate student. So how interesting the timing of that. And sure enough, it wasn't another 3 years before I found myself carrying this text on my back and bowing to the ground and reciting its name once every three steps, which is certainly bizarre behavior for somebody who had never heard the name of this book three years earlier. So who knows why we come around tonight here, December 16th, 2014 in Berkeley, California. Think of all the other things you could be doing tonight. Saturday night, some of the young folks in the audience are going, yeah, I thought about it a lot, you know. She dragged me here, you know. It's like, I didn't want to come in, you know. Well, I understand that totally, and let's see if we can't make it interesting and worth your while to come. Those of you who sought us out by clicking on links in your tablet, your iPad, or your Samsung device, or your computer, welcome. This will be archived later for viewing later if you care to return, and there's a string of lectures below in your YouTube feed, Dharma Realm Live, from weeks past. So some people get so connected to the text that they actually want to know how it comes out, right? Kind of like when you read a novel and it's a page turner, you know, it's like, what's the Buddha going to say next? What happens next? You know, stay tuned for the next installment of the Flower Garland Sutra, brought to you by the Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. Why not? There's wisdom here. And although it's a book with pages that you turn, on the other hand, it's uncovering layers of your own mind. The deepest part of who I think I am, the Buddha knows a layer deeper. Right? And when you understand that and absorb what he wants us to know, what he discovered and is passing on, there's a layer below that. We're only on layer 6 out of 10 in this particular chapter, so there's more to learn. So let's dig in. If you want these to page 16 and 17, those of you who do not have a copy of the text, where is it available? It's a PDF on the... Okay. Great. I'm looking at Alan, who is here. Alan Huang has given me some directions that this text, if you want to download it, as they say, a copy for your very own, if you would like a copy for yourself, you can over on the berkeleymonastery.org, berkeleymonastery.org. That website has links to the texts that we're explaining. And also, it's got a downloadable PDF version of the transfer of merit, the dedication of merit that's coming up at the end. Oh, right. Let me tell you what's going to happen tonight. We're going to be... Excuse me again. Working on the text until just before 9 o'clock. Then we're going to transfer the merit. And then I have to share with everybody a collection of photographs from my recent visit to Taiwan, which was just now, 10 days ago, I came back. And we've got we sorted them through. Instead of 556 photographs, which would be a new explanation of suffering, that's probably the ninth kind of suffering is, you know, home movies, right? Instead, we have 135 photographs that we have selected for your viewing pleasure tonight. So, with stories behind them. So if you'll hang in, we'll share with you some of the goings-on in Taiwan during our recent visit. And it's there's some familiar faces for those of you who are old friends here, and some new stories, some interesting things to learn about how Buddha Dharma is coming from Asia to the West and then back to Asia. So that's ahead. And there may be a couple songs thrown in for good measure. We'll see how the time goes. Then after this, the photos are going to give some announcements of coming events here in the Berkeley community of the Dharma Realm Buddhist Association. Page 17, do you have that on your text, 16 and 17, down at the bottom, the very, very bottom, the last line. And because our text came originally in a Chinese version, and we are now working on our English version, so we honor that original Chinese and keep it at hand. So we have a bilingual. The version we're working with is bilingual. So Chinese on this side, English on this side. And we first read the Chinese, and then we reference it as we go. But our lecture is in English. Okay? We're lecturing English. We do have a Vietnamese translation going on simultaneously in the balcony here, so this is a bilingual sutra lecture, and there are rumors that if we had enough Chinese speakers, we could get a Mandarin translation going. At the moment, we don't have one, and I suppose if we had a Spanish speaker here who wanted to volunteer, we could get a really muy bueno, you know, Spanish translation happening. Japanese, not so much, but maybe in the future, we don't know, we'll try. Polish translation, right? So, All right. So tonight, English and Vietnamese. Here we go. I'm going to give you a line, and you give it back to me. Here we go.
佛子始终无名，爱取不断，是烦恼大。
Please turn over. That period, okay, right. Let's do the Chinese here. Ready?
行有不断，是业道；余分不断，是苦道；前后积分别灭，三道断。
如是三道离我，我所，但有生灭，有如树庐。Okay, please turn back to the English. We're at the bottom of 17. Everybody got a copy? Very bottom, the last line. Okay, here we go. Can we do it together? Can we read in unison? I'll start and we'll all come together. Here we go. Disciples of the Buddha, when ignorance, love, and grasping are not stopped, that is the path towards affliction. When activities and existence are not stopped, that is the path towards the creation of karma. When the other links are not stopped, that is the path towards suffering. Still, when we stop discriminating between before and after, all three paths cease. In this way, the three paths are free of self and what belongs to the self. But birth and death still exist like a bundle of dried grass. Now, okay, we explained this last week. We touched on it. We had a long discussion of it. We had some corrected ideas. And during the week, people came back and gave me some suggestions about better ways to translate. So we're going to work with this basic translation, and then improve it as we go. For folks who are joining us maybe for the first time or haven't been part of this particular message, this is going to seem a little cryptic, a little confusing, kind of hard to grab. The words don't really make sense off right on the face of it. And the reason for that is because the Buddha is describing a series of changes that take place inside of us and in the world around us invisibly, but absolutely. This is something going on inside of us right this minute, as the Buddha was describing. And yet, without his, you could say, x-ray vision, we don't know it. So this is one of those places where it's kind of unusual in Buddhist texts, you quote, take it on faith until you experience it yourself. Usually the Buddha doesn't do that. He doesn't say, this is how it is, believe it. He usually says, wise people have endorsed this. Try it. If you like it, it's yours. Wise people talk against this. Avoid it, or you'll suffer. Try it yourself. Not recommend it, you know. So he usually presents it as experience and then encourages us to towards wisdom and compassion. So there are teachings in the Dharma that when you read it, you go, yeah, that makes perfect sense. That's logical. That's my own experience. That makes sense. There's a lot of Buddha Dharma that's like that. It kind of resonates in your own good heart. That's true. I like that. That makes sense to me because I've experienced that. Some of the Dharma goes beyond the experience of somebody who has not quieted their mind. This is one of those places. So what's the key to understanding this part of the text is you have to be a good meditator. Be a good meditator. But here's why it's really worth it to open this up and to look. It's because who gets to be a good meditator? Anybody. gets to be a good meditator if you apply yourself. And the value of doing that is you understand yourself at a whole new level. Why do we want to understand ourselves at a whole new level? We mess up less when we understand ourselves at that level. We can catch our minds before we go wrong. Furthermore, we can put all of our heart behind the goodness that we want to do when we understand ourselves better. That's the point. So there are people who say the Buddha's teaching boils down to three things. Do no evil, do everything that's good to do, and purify your mind. 是诸佛教, they say. That's what the Buddha taught. And you could say, yeah. So in other words, the whole Buddha Dharma is a moralistic teaching. It's just all about good and bad, good and evil. Yeah, if that's the way you see it, you can absolutely do it that way. Why bother? Why is the Buddha telling us about activities in existence stopping? That's code language, isn't it? That's really opaque. You know, you look at it and you can't make sense out of it. Well, it's not that it doesn't make sense. It's that, number one, we have to be sure that we know what he said. What does this code language refer to? And then number two, we have to understand it, we have to, the phrase, walk the path the Buddha walked. So what road, what sidewalk did the Buddha walk on? You'd be right if you said virtue, concentration, insight, that path. The Chinese for that is jie ding hui. The Sanskrit for that is shila samadhi prajna. Precepted behavior, wise behavior, a still and quiet mind, and then following the insights that come from that mind. Then you go, oh yeah, well, the Buddha is like, this is like a cookbook. What's in a cookbook? Recipes. Right? Why do you open a cookbook? Recipes. You want to make blueberry pancakes? Start with flour, you know, get some butter, margarine, safflower oil margarine. Get some blueberries, you know, and it step by step, how much flour, how much water, how much, you know. This is a recipe. The Buddha is saying, do you want to understand where pain and suffering come from? Here's where. Do you want pain and suffering to stop? Here's how. That's our chapter. Okay? And anybody who's sitting here tonight or listening tonight who has never experienced pain or suffering, you don't need this. You take a break, you know, nail, you know, make a cup of coffee. You're free, you know. We'll give you a buy. We'll give you a pass. Anybody else, fasten your seatbelt. This is the recipe. This is good stuff. That's why the Buddha explained it. If we're kind of like distilling everything down to the essence tonight, right? So we had do no evil, do good deeds, purify your mind. We had precepts, concentration, and wisdom, these kind of essences, right? There's another one. There's a real powerful way to explain what the Buddha was about, and that's he couldn't accept the fact that he was going to die. Further, he couldn't accept the fact that he was going to get old. He saw that. And he couldn't accept the fact that illness was part of having a body. Those three things had not been part of his childhood. Growing up, the Buddha was utterly, totally isolated from any kind of change, any kind of pain. Didn't happen. He never watched a TV show that had anybody old or sick on it. You know, ER, right? Emergency. He never saw that. He never watched a single, you know, detective show where somebody got shot and the detective had to find out who it was. No such thing in the Buddha's experience. No pain. no sickness, old age, death. The three out of eight sufferings were not part of his experience at all until suddenly, boom, 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 within a very short period of time, when he was already a mature, strapping young man, he saw an old person, he saw a sick person, and he saw a corpse. Stopped his world. Couldn't handle it. No context, no preparation. And with him on this tour of the city's gates was his driver, his chauffeur, who said to him, he said, "Yes, Your Majesty, Your Highness, everybody gets old, everybody gets sick, everybody dies." And you can imagine the prince saying, "Me too?" And, "Yes, Your Highness, you too." So he said, "No way," essentially. "Ikemasen ne," he said. "Doesn't work. Bōxīng. Can't accept that. What do I do?" And at the fourth gate, aha, good timing. Here was the ascetic cultivator who said, "Ah, Your Highness," he said, "simply cultivate the path that ends suffering." And the prince said something like, "Who can do that?" And the ascetic said, "You, Your Highness, can." Or probably didn't say Your Highness. He said, "You, poor suffering fellow traveler, you too can end suffering. Follow me." And he did. He did. So that's real essential. If we keep that in mind, this suddenly goes click, click, I see. What is this? This is the answer that he discovered in 12 steps. It's a lot. 12 steps. In 12 of anything we kind of react against. That's a lot of steps. 12 steps to describe where the suffering comes from and how to make it stop. That's what's on these pages. And that's the code. Okay? That's why we have these strange lists of terms. This is the Buddha's recipe for pain cake and donuts, you know, sweet donuts. So misery cake, thistle cake, and donuts. So what did he say? He said, when ignorance, love, and grasping are not stopped, that's the path towards affliction. When activities in existence are not stopped, that's heading towards karma. When the other links are not stopped, that's the path towards suffering. Three paths. And he said, okay, this is what makes life miserable, is affliction. And what was our word last week? Troubles. Yeah, we came up with troubles as a translation for affliction. Affliction is one of those 75-cent words that you kind of read in dissertations and on medical write-ups and things. But a word that we know about is trouble. I got trouble. Uh-oh, you're in trouble. You know. And affliction is that. Two, karma, in this case, we're always, every time the word karma pops up these days, we're trying to expand the definition of karma, because people in popular culture pretty much think karma means bad karma, something you don't want. That's only half the story. In fact, karma can also be good karma, just the way you can plant seeds that grow potatoes, and you can plant seeds that grow cherries. Potatoes are kind of bland and starchy. Cherries are sweet and juicy. It's up to you what you plant. The ground will grow them both, right? Karma is neutral. It's a neutral word. It simply means behavior and its results. So action and what comes from it. Action and reaction is karma. So wholesome actions, wholesome results. Unwholesome, unskillful actions and unskillful results you don't want. That's the path towards karma. Furthermore, there's a path towards suffering if you don't stop those links heading that way. So, stopping those behaviors is key to what's happening here. The Buddha pointed to troubles, karma, probably bad karma here, things you don't want, and suffering, misery, pain, is a result of these links going forward, pulling each other. 12 links, they call them. 12 chain links, right? Link of a chain, tug one, they all come. You don't have to find a chain, you have to find a loose thread in your... I got a loose thread anywhere? Nope, I guess I trimmed them all. Nope, nothing loose here. But I'll just tug on my sleeve. There you go. Ready? All right, you tug here and the whole fabric moves. Linked, right? So the 12 links tug in that way. And there's an experience that you have when they move forward. The Buddha said three paths, three things happen. One is troubles. One is reactions that somehow happen. Don't know quite how it happened. And then misery behind it. Now, one way to look at what this is wisdom. This is the wisdom teachings. Is there a lot of compassion here? Only when you apply it. Say the Buddha was trying to point all this out. What's he talking about? He's talking like a doctor. When you go to the doctor's office and he says, Mrs. Smith, would you come into my office? You know, and he's got that look on his face. And you go, bad news ahead. Right? I don't think I want to hear what his charts are going to tell him, what the results of the test. The Buddha's like that tonight. He's saying, here's facts of life that most of us don't want to hear, but he doesn't stop there. He says, I've got a medicine. If you don't stop it, then results are going to happen. You won't want them. If you do stop it, the results don't happen. You'll be happier. So there's always, some people say that, you know, Buddha Dharma is so pessimistic. It's all suffering all the time. They say, suffering, suffering, suffering. And that's a misreading of what's here, because what's here includes the end of it. Why? Because he did it. The Buddha actually did it. The Buddha stopped the suffering, and then he said, here's how you can do it too. So in other words, his struggle, the Buddha's challenge, which was, I'm going to see if death is inevitable. I want to see if death can be avoided. Sure enough, right? He took on death as his opponent. What a struggle. We give ourselves lesser challenges mostly, right? We want to try to get to school on time today through the traffic. That's our challenge, right? Well, here's the Buddha saying, no, I want to see if death will end. And he succeeded. And then he said, here's how. Here's the path. All right. That's clear. Now, what about this part about before and after? Qian hou ji fen bie mie san dao duan ru shi san dao li wo suo dan you sheng mie you ru shu lu. Okay, let's look at the Chinese. He says, qian hou ji. Qian, earlier. Hou, later. Another way to talk about it would be past and future. Ji, boundaries. Fen bie, chopping up, discriminating. Is the 75-cent word. When you, actually it's interesting, fen and bie, both those words have the knife radical. The Chinese character has the word dao in there. You fen bie, when you go like chopping up cabbage to throw into the dumplings, right? So when we chop, the boundaries, the borders, the limits, the extension of what came before and what comes afterwards, mie, over, stopped, ended, finished. When we stop, chop, the boundaries of past and present, past and future, comma, san dao duan, those three paths are over. Those three paths stop. How? What? How does that work? He's not done. Ru shi san dao li wo wo suo dan you sheng mie you ru shu ru. Where does discriminations of past and future happen? Where do we make those distinctions? That was before, this is to come. That's in the mind. Thoughts, in other words. When we have thoughts of this happened before, this is going to happen, when we stop doing that, when we leave those thoughts, he says, then troubles, karma, and pain go away. Likewise, ru shi, in the same way, in this is how san dao, those three paths of trouble and karma and pain, nowhere can you find a self or wosuo, me and mine, my identity, doesn't exist in those three paths. There's no such thing fundamentally as me and mine in the mind. If you can get rid of it, if you can stop it in your thoughts. Okay, it's like, in order to make sense of this, you got to hold a couple things in your mind. There is something left, however, danyo sheng mie, yo ru shu lu. There is still coming into being and passing away, just like, I should have brought an example, just like string strung around a handful of reeds. Somebody corrected me. This is not grass. It should be reeds. R-E-E-D-S. What's a reed? Okay, if you've ever been down, we call them cattails, right? Yep, there are not so many cattails in California, maybe out in the country. In Ohio, where I grew up, cattails were part of like pretty much by the roadside. You just go riding along. Anybody have cattails near your home? You see them? There were some in Australia in our pond, and they were planted there by somebody who'd never seen cattails actually growing, so they separated them, one there and one there. Cattails grow in a clump. They're a grass, but they're a reed, and they have this brown, it looks like a cattail. It's like a, you know, a long-haired tortoiseshell, brown. And what is it about reeds? Hollow. They're hollow. You can, you know, hold them up and look through them, down to the joint. And in a way, bamboo is that same kind of grass. That's what you think of bamboo, how hollow it is. So why is the Buddha giving us this image? He's saying, in our lives, there's a way to make troubles, fannao, afflictions. What are troubles? Greed is a trouble, affliction. Anger is a trouble. Delusion, pride, and doubt. Those are the five basic troubles. Those are parts of our human life that cause us trouble. They're not fundamental. They don't have to poison us. They're also poisons. right? They don't have to poison us, but they're troubles. They trouble us. We can get rid of them. If me and mine are not there, if my thoughts are not dominated by what? Ego. That's not exactly an equivalent. Ego is Western, it's a Freudian word. Been part of our culture for 150 years. But it's not an exact equivalent. The Buddha described it as self, the pudgala, he said. Self is this constructed sense of me in the middle. I'm the center of the world and everything, all you guys are outside. I live in here and it's kind of lonely and it kind of echoes in there. And sometimes I'm really happy, other times I'm like not happy. And sometimes I'm scared, other times I'm like just seem to be very light and in harmony and bliss. That's the self, that thing. And the Buddha says, because of this habit that we have, starting with what? Ignorance. We had it back here. Ignorance, love, and grasping, three out of those 12 links. When those are things that we live with and make really important in our lives, it all lands on our head. All the suffering happens from that. That's how it starts. That's how the troubles come. Right in the middle of that process, if we can not distinguish, that was in the past, I'm here at the present, and that's coming. If we can let those thoughts gradually still and go away, along with the self, which vanishes with that sense of present, past, future, when we stop funbie, stop thinking about, I used to be a failure, but I'm going to be a success in the future, damn it. You know, get out of my way. Success ahead, you know. Those kind of like discriminations, or I know I'm going to be a failure. I won't even try the test because I've never succeeded in a test, and I'm just the middle daughter, and you know, my older sister is really the one who's got all the skills, and I'm just, you know. All those thoughts, inferiority, superiority, pride, low self-esteem, all of those thoughts are, says the Buddha, funbie. That's all discriminations that we make needlessly in the darkness of uming, of ignorance. And as soon as we can actually get to the root of those thoughts and let them go, suffering ends. That's the problem. The Buddha's pointing right to this war, me and mine. And here's, this is, we pointed this out last week, this is what is kind of poignant and neat, and I want people to recognize it. What does he say? Ru shi san dao li wo wo suo dan you sheng mie you ru shu lu. Even though we can get rid of all the poison, get rid of all the delusions in there, those three paths, things you don't want, right? Like troubles, karma, and misery, suffering, cool. Birth and death still happen. Like what? Like cattails. There you see them, you squeeze them, there's nothing there. Shulu. You tie a string around them, you have a bunch, right? Untie the string, they fall apart. They fundamentally didn't exist, but the form is still there. Why is this poignant? People still die, but we don't suffer. There's never been a Buddha who didn't enter nirvana. There's never been anyone alive whose life didn't go through old age, sickness, and death, but the suffering is optional. Pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. If you can see it this way, it's just a coming together and a coming apart of forms, of causes and links. Okay? So here's the Buddha saying, check the recipe, This is a donut. You're going to want it. It's really tasty. It's yummy. This is how the suffering, how that the pain stops. This is how the pain stops. So there was earlier in the Ten Grounds, in the first one, the Buddha described the end to fear. He was talking about fear, fivefold fears. And he was saying that when you really see through the self in your meditation, when your meditation is so quiet that you realize that this thing that I hold in the middle is so important and precious is just a way of seeing. It doesn't have any actual permanent existence. That my identity is a connection with all things in a deeper sense. What you see is there's simply habit patterns that when those are quiet, this body is just, he calls it like dried wood, he said. There's nothing really there. It's a collection of stuff. It's just a way of looking. Earth, air, fire, water comes together. And yet we are so used to seeing it as most important, number one, right? So what's the answer? The Buddha's answer was middle way. Stick to the middle way. You have to eat. You have to wash. You have to be kind. If you can go beyond that and benefit others, then you're on the Bodhisattva path. Then you've reached the Mahayana. That's the Buddha's wisdom of compassion. So, there we go. There's our message. Interesting, huh? You think, oh yeah, that's a bunch of code, but I get the bigger picture. I see what it's about. Hai! Okina koe de onegai shimasu. Alice, wait one second. We got a microphone coming over here. Yeah, go for it. Alan, can you help out with that? Yeah, is it on? Did you press the? Okay, we're not successful with that mic. Keep going. I'm following. I just want to hear it again. Three periods of time. Mm-hmm. So, fan nao, zhe ge ye hai you ku. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Discrimination, yeah. Separate.
So the Qianhou Qi is the term means separately stuff. Then, of course, the three paths will be.
Okay.
Because if the tail rings on top is here, it doesn't mean
Right.
So, but only on top the 12 leaves, then the affliction, suffering,
cool. Mm-hmm.
But along the Qianhou is not really about the time, but about
the sequence. Sequence, okay. I got louder too when she got louder, so I know. Yeah. Okay, Alice is asking about the sentence here, and this is, let's all use our best wisdom. See, this, she is giving us another perspective on it. So, 前后继, 分别灭, 三道断. She's saying, instead of translating 前后 as past and future, she's saying, could it refer to the sequence of the 12 links? And if we don't break them up, if we see it as an adverb, like continuously, right? Is that correct, Alice? Is that? Separately. Like individually almost. Yeah. Okay. Do you want to say again in Chinese what you just said? Is that, your English is perfectly fine. But can I just your thought? Maybe everybody else can listen to you. 你再用中文再讲一次, 好吧? Okay, great. So she's saying she understands it better with that idea about the qian and the ho. What do folks think? This is a really, thank you for opening it up. This is a good chance to discuss this. What do you think? What's going on here? Clearly, it's important. This is important stuff, because why the Buddha's saying, here's how suffering is. What is he talking about, sandao, first of all? Why does he point out fannao, affliction, troubles, ye, karma, and ku, pain, suffering, as paths? Why are these paths? And how does it happen? It seems, if we fill this in, you've got warfare, you've got disease, you've got famine, you've got food shortages, you've got flooding and Katrina, the hurricane, and San Francisco earthquake, that's all in this. Old age, seniors care, right? Mortuaries, all of this stuff is all written inside this. This is, I'm just putting some real nerves that hurt when, the Buddha's giving us theory here, but we're putting into practice, and it's like misery, stuff you don't want. Somebody dies, That's what's going on. And here he's saying, that can stop if we see it this way. So, Alice's proposal was that this is the way she understands it better, is when you stop cutting up the 12 links from ignorance all the way to old age, sickness, and death, then the three paths, those three things that are so miserable, stop. That's the way she sees it. It's not past and future. Okay? YC? Why did I know you were about this? Let's hear what you think. And then the guys, come on, guys. Like, the women are really like, you got, come on. You gotta compete. Come on. Get some thought. Gotta turn out the gears, man. Otherwise, how can you face? Okay. How? Nigga, is the other mic? Maybe the other one is better? Did we get the wrong one by any chance? I've got. Hello.
Amitabha.
There we go. It's competing with me, yeah. speak separate.
Alex, Alex,他提的idea是很好，可以给我们思考。 可是我们要考虑到，这个前后记是不是一个专有名词？ 它通常前后记就是讲过去、现在和未来，那所以我们可以做一些研究，看前后记有没有用在不是讲时间的。 那另外呢，这个文章你看哈，它前面讲说，无名爱取不断是烦恼道，那有个不断，不断就是相续连续的，所以它时间性。那行有不断是业道，余分不断是苦道，所以那个不断是讲那个它连续，就是它有个时间性。所以这里前后记。 可能就还是相关于时间的，就是从过去到未来，它是相续不断的。Sorry,
we'll this is a group.
Yeah, I think Alex, Alex is suggesting give us a point to consider the translation of the text. But what I think is the terminology in Buddhism, usually the 前后记 is a terminology refer to the time of the past and the future. And also, for the sentence, the first sentence is says, 爱取不断是烦恼道, love and the grasping are not stopped. Not stopped, it means it continues from past to future. So, and all the three passes, they say, not stopped, that all refers to from past to future continues. So in my opinion, it is still refers to timing, past and future, not of the 12 links.
Thank you. That's helpful. What I heard Alice say was this helps her understand it, helps her approach it. And in that regard, any interpretation is okay. Now, YC is saying traditionally, qian hou is time. And that's how I took it. But I also get like, with another understanding of when you view these in succession, the three paths stop. What we're trying to do is open a door here. Look at the next paragraph. So I'm hoping that there'll be some ideas coming from all over the room here. You ready? We ready? Moving on? Take a look. With these questions in mind, look at what's next. 父次无名缘行者是观过去是乃至受是观现在爱乃至有是观未来与是以后辗转相续无名灭性灭者是观待断 All right. Here we go. Furthermore, ignorance conditioning mental formations is contemplation of the past. Consciousness up to and including feeling is contemplation of the present. Love up to and including existence is contemplation of the future. After that, the 12 links continue to cycle through. But the contemplation of, quote, ignorance ends then mental formations end is the contemplation of how the linking process can cease. Okay, what's going on? Here's what's going on. People who study the sixth ground, when somebody says, what are you reading? What are you studying on Saturday night? You say, we're studying what are called the 12 links. That's the short name. We have about, you know, how many? 8 translations of the full name. Each one is good. Conditioned arising, conditioned co-production, mutual interpenetration, you know, various names for it. 12 links. What are you studying? 12 links. What is it? It's how old age, sickness, and death comes from ignorance. 12 steps. And when ignorance stops, old age, sickness, and death, and its suffering stop. That's what it's about. This is the answer to the Buddha's search for can pain, can death stop? This is his answer. Yes, it can. Here's how it happens. Here's how it stops. Okay? That's the big picture. Now, in our text, in our sixth ground, the Buddha takes that formula that he gave us and he analyzes it 10 times over. We're in like number 8 here. The last bunch of lectures, disciples of the Buddha, the Bodhisattva then thinks, from page 13, everything in the threefold realms is a single thought. But the Buddha spins that into 12 branches. But all 12 branches go back to a single thought. Why? He said. Okay? So that was the key. So all of this that we have, all these curious coming together, three paths, self and what belongs to the self, stopping, etc. The Buddha is giving us 10 ways of looking at that. Okay. Crystal, flower vase. Anybody enlightened? Okay. So, conditions weren't right. All right. So, you take this flower vase and the sun shines in the kitchen of the house. You hold it up to the sun and through this beautiful cut glass comes a spectrum of light. Red, green, yellow, blue, right? You turn it slightly and it comes at another angle. Turn it again, it comes at another angle, right? Turn the lights, put it up against the wall, away from the window, there's no light at all. That's what the Buddha is doing here. He's holding up his formula of the 12 links like a prism and turning it. And our text are the 10 rays of light that come off it. The Avatamsaka always gives 10 things. That's what makes this sutra, gives the sutra the flavor that it has. And we're in the middle of 10 ways of looking at the 12 links, so we understand them. That's kind of the broccoli and the tofu of our text, right? The meat and potatoes of our text. 10 ways of looking at 12 links. So we're in the middle of that right now. That's what's going on. The Buddha just said, if you look at 12 links, 12 of them, if you look at Wu Ming Yuan Xing, links 1 and 2, that's past. Out and out, definite time past. Guo Qu, right? Couldn't be clearer. That's what happened before. Because I was covered in darkness, I did things. Mental formations, that's Xing, right? I had the planted the seeds, you could say, for stuff to happen. Okay? That's a contemplation of Guo Qu. This is just a way of seeing it. The Buddha is giving us the formula. Shi, Niger Shou. Step number 3, which was consciousness arising after the seed is planted, up to feeling, Shi Guan Xian Zai. That's the links from 3 to Guan Shi Yuan Ming Si, Ming Si Yuan Liu Ru, Liu Ru Yan Chu, Chu Yuan Shou, to 5. So, no, 7, right? So 3 to 7, links 3 to 7 is happening at this moment, which then leads to I, Niger Yo, love, craving, existence. Those three, that's what happens in the future. Okay? Yu Shi Yi Ho, Zhang Zhuan Xiang Xu. The others from that point on just keep rolling on. Okay, so numbers 9, 10, 11, 12, says the Buddha. Another way to look at these 12 links, he says. So you can divide them up in with a yardstick of time. Past, if you don't catch them, present happens. That's going on, leading to the future. Wu ming mie, xing mie zhe, shi guan dai duan. He says, however, if at that first link, wu ming mie, when you put an end, when you light up ignorance and you see it, then those mental formations don't have to, you don't plant the seeds. This is a contemplation of how it can stop. Is that a good translation of guan dai duan? I struggle with that one. This is how it all can stop. Okay. Hearing no further opinions, the motion carries. Meeting adjourned. Yes, Alan. Okay. Give that man a microphone. Alan? Here's your mic. Yeah. This is a good question. We have a question online, just a sec. So.
Yeah. No, the online YouTube.
So people on YouTube, on our channel, can type in your questions. Welcome.
So the question is about, wouldn't breaking the 12 links be liberation, and thus not subject to birth and death, karma, past, present, future, because these things never existed in the first place, or is this is a difference?
Often mind comes back. There we go. Good. Correct. In other words, yes. That's the short answer to your question. If you can put an end to ignorance, that is indeed liberation. That's the Buddha's point. That's what he says. And where does it happen? In your mind. That's what's so distinctly Buddhist, i.e. awakened, about this. Nobody knows. Nobody can do anything about it. You can't buy it. You can't borrow it. You can't steal it. You can't get it on Amazon.com. You can't have it delivered. You can't download it. It happens in your mind when ignorance stops. How does ignorance stop? Well, ignorance, avidya, no light in Sanskrit, wu ming, no light in Chinese, happens when light arrives, when you light it up. How do you light it up? You light it up by seeing that, as our questioner said, those things didn't really exist until you put them into action. The problem is we can't be patient. We can't wait. And our senses are designed to lead us out. And so we think, oh, if I could just have another piece of cake, I would be happier than I am after this first piece of cake. You eat that second piece of cake and I don't feel so good, especially with the ice cream. Too much, your stomach is cold and you have a stomach ache. Why? One spoon of sugar is sweet, the second spoon of sugar must be sweeter. Turns out, too much. We can't be patient. We're always pulled out through our senses into what seems like the world outside, when in fact, had we just been patient, all that fullness would be there. Master Hua would say, Sherpa would say, you know, cultivators of the way, he would say, they have to be patient and they have to endure a little bit of discomfort. If you can be patient and not greedy and you can endure a little bit of discomfort, you can stay in samadhi and everything's okay. But it's so hard, especially when our marketplace world tells us that fun awaits the next purchase, right? It's all, we want to have some fun. So we go out and have fun, but the fun pulls us out into the world. We wind up depleted, pursuing faster, a bit more, pain's coming, pleasure's ahead, pain's coming, pleasure's ahead, pursuing. And then there are people who, in the midst of that ignorance, just go on and do things that you wonder about. Did you hear about the Korean Airlines heiress? That? Macadamia nuts. They're, from now on, worldwide, with the internet being what it is, worldwide, the next time you see macadamia nuts, you're going to think of her. Her face is going to pop up. In Korea, there is this thing called chaejol, and it's, I think it must be guizu or something like that. I don't know what the Chinese behind that Korean word is, but it means aristocrats. And there's a culture in where if you're a big, powerful family, you can do what you want. That's how the culture has come down for hundreds of years. And the Koreans, being a very democratically minded people, are fed up. They, enough of this. There's a manifestation of it that's brought it to the attention of the press and now the world, which is the chairman of Korea Air's daughter, 40-year-old woman, is the head of services and also vice president of Korea Air, kind of, I guess, because dad gave her the job. And she was on a flight from Seoul to where? Where was she going? Bangkok? Going to Bangkok or something. And she was in first class, and the head steward served her macadamia nuts in a bag. He didn't open the bag and put them in a dish. She threw a fit, had him kneel in front of her, apologize fully, screamed at him, and stopped the plane and sent it back to the gate in order to throw him off the plane, the head of this head steward, you know. And people said, no, you can't do that. And it got to the press, and she now has made a formal apology. Her father has said, foolish, he said. I raised her badly. She was badly raised, he said. So I take full blame, he said, which is noble on his part, you know. And the poor woman, you know, she is now with her head making a full bow of apology in the front of the press. And the Board of Transportation, the Transportation Board in Korea may punish her. It might not stop with she may have to, like, because she was in international airspace, she's impacting traffic for a bag of macadamia nuts, you know. So that's just one of those stories of somebody whose sense of self grew into other people's space. You know, her needs were inflated to the place where they actually potentially caused an airplane accident. Plane crash. That's a plane crash. We talk about a train wreck. Well, that was a plane crash. So macadamia nuts, poor woman. That's kind of the symbol of, and who knows, maybe Korea, this having bubbled up now, will be able to say this sense of entitlement because of wealth and power in a time of democratic republics is probably over. We need to make that kind of behavior unacceptable from now on. So we'll see. Anyway, but there's a sense of that self being just so big that it gets too ludicrous. And as her father said, foolish. What is a fool? A fool is someone who, because of ignorance, sees things the way they're not. It's not the way they are. You know, like macadamia nuts taste just fine whether you open the bag or somebody opens it for you. They're equally good in the dish or out of the bag. You certainly don't have to punish your employee for that kind of behavior. So ignorance. So I was, who else has a comment? How are we going to understand this? There's coming up, we're, the next, did I just lose my mic here? The next paragraph talks about, cool. We're going to get there next Saturday. Cool. That's a powerful word in Buddhism because it's suffering. Translated. Not every time. Cool in the Sanskrit word is dukkha. Dukkha. And it's key in Buddhism because it was the first thing the Buddha taught. The first teaching out of his mouth was about dukkha and how it comes about and how it stops. Where does pain come from? Where does it end? That was called the Four Noble Truths, right? And Buddhism, some people say, you know, you Buddhists, you're just so pessimistic. It's all dukkha, 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 you know, suffering all the time. Why don't you lighten up a little bit? Have some fun every now and then. Relax, you Buddhists. So, yeah, I get that. But there's no doubt that as soon as pain comes to my senses, to my body, to my nerves, I grab for the Tylenol. Advil. You know, how does suffering stop? That's the answer to the third noble truth. Suffering can stop. Advil. Yeah, but then when Advil wears off, then what? You know, well, Suntory whiskey. That's next. But then when that wears off, then what? Oh, well, who cares, you know. If that were true, then every Irish person would be carefree. Every Russian person would be blissful, you know. Vodka, you know. Yeah. Nah. Temporary solutions versus ultimate solutions. That's what the Buddha's talking about. Now, key to understanding what the Buddha was talking about was not suffering so much as dissatisfaction is key to understanding dukkha. It's not all pain. I mean, people are sitting here in the Buddha hall and it's not necessarily painful here. Kind of nice, actually, in a neutral kind of way. But it sure can be unsatisfying. Unsatisfying. What? Pretty much everything. In English, street talk, what do we say? Doesn't hit the spot. Doesn't do it for me. That we can identify with, right? What are some other words? Frustration. Anxiety. Bummer. Discouraging. Unsatisfying. Didn't hit the spot, right? Those are words we probably are not too far from our mind a lot during the day, such as the economy, the environment, my relationship with my parents, with my kids, with my teacher, with my students. Not the way I'd want it. That's what the Buddha was talking about, as well as pain, right? Pain, ouch, impacts your body. Not necessarily. We go through the whole day. How many pains do we have today? Well, if you're 65 like I am, a lot, right? More than before. But who escapes that sense of didn't hit the, not what I wanted, not what I was hoping for, not what I expected. Disappointing. Really let me down. Didn't hit the spot. Ah, dukkha. That is also connected here in the word dukkha. Then there's another level of dukkha which has nothing to do with pain and the senses, unsatisfying to the mind. It has to do with things falling apart. Things falling apart. Right? Like what? Like everything. Everything, everything. There's another, and here's where I wanted to talk to Alice and to YC and to the other, the questioner online. there's a place where the Buddha is describing these 12 links that is more molecular, chemistry, physics, which is what? The Buddha is describing how matter becomes energy, goes back to matter, where particles become waves, become particles, where form and emptiness kind of dance. One rises out of the dark and becomes a form, and then it goes back into the dark, and then another form, right? You shift your eyes, you know, the duck rabbit? Everybody on Facebook at one point sees the duck rabbit. Somebody sends it out. You focus your eyes this way. It looks like a duck. You focus your eyes, and the bill of the duck is ears of a rabbit. You seen that one, the duck rabbit? You know, you just keep refocusing and form and emptiness go, right? You can, when I describe it, you can see it, right? The bill of the duck are the ears of the rabbit. And you focus, refocus, and oh, it's a duck. No, it's a rabbit, right? And like Mobius strips and the drawings of, who's the artist? Who always, he drives, there's a staircase up to nothing. Escher, M.C. Escher. That was popular in the 70s, Escher's book of drawings. So, like form and emptiness are always doing this, right? They're like, you see it one way and then it's gone. And then it's back. Waves and particles, right? Form and emptiness. Energy and matter. The Buddha's describing that as moving through that strange matrix that we're in when karma, when we act, when we do stuff out of ignorance, we're in the mind, we're planting this garden of things that grow into, he says, a tree of suffering. You can stop it, but you got to be a skillful gardener. And these are the places to do it, he says. At love and grasping, at activities, love and grasping. Do it there, and you're in the Garden of Eden. You're in a peaceful place. Miss it there, and here we go again, round one more time. How powerful this is. So that's another level of dukkha. It's called why things are always falling apart. Because, and you don't have to say it's bad. It's just the way things are. They come into being, they go apart. Come into being, they go apart. As much as we're attached, that's how much we hurt. Deep, 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 deep insight. Who can see this? You, if you sit there long enough and you're quiet and use a method. You'll see it. Because it's happening right now to all of us. Happening fastest in these hydrocarbons that are here, like really temporarily. This one goes bad in like 2 days. You see it goes right back to compost because these are volatile bonds. The bonds are not very stable. This fired at what kind of heat put this glass? This is sand. Now it's a glass table, right? That's a little sturdier, but you put it in enough heat, it'll experience white cool one more time. The bonds will loosen and it's back to form, to emptiness. You know. So there's that level too. Next week, stay tuned. We will be talking about the three kinds of suffering. Cool, cool, xing cool, white cool. Ordinary pain, the suffering, they call it a process, which is the samskaras, that's the 12 links. And then the suffering of things fall apart. And it's all dukkha. How neat. Depending on your level of stillness, this teaching suddenly comes alive. I found, this is a journal that I wrote in June of 1979. Shifu said, Master Hua said, enduring suffering ends suffering. Enjoying blessings puts an end to your blessings. He said, what are you laughing about? That's the truth. I'll drink to that. Right? enjoying your bliss. So, how to end suffering, said my journal. Endure it. Why? Because if I run from it, if I wiggle around and avoid it, if I call it bad, I never reach the place of pingdang, level equality. When I can see all dharmas as equal, that's liberation. The highest state is no attachments. So take it, bear it, be patient, level it all out, put down the fear of change. Easy to say, hard to do. Harder still is to put down the craving for pleasure. You can, saying to myself, end desires by giving them away. Hold on to your blessings by giving them away. When you can stay, rest in Wushang Pingdang Chu, the supreme place of equality, the level, impartial, proper Dharma, praised by all the Buddhas, the suffering goes away. It's raining like mad. The cars careen by like banshees on the prowl. Water soaks up my sleeves all the way to the armpits. Gravel cuts my knees with each bow. Kids jeer at you from passing trucks. Suffering? Only if you call it suffering. If you pull the self back, it's just a movie. You're sitting in full lotus. The energy circulates like warm honey, opening muscles tense and hard, soothing the soul in places you didn't know you could feel pleasure. You think it will go on forever. Bliss? Only if you need to name it. Weren't you in agony in the rain just an hour ago? Who felt the pain? Who feels the pleasure now? Are they different? Check it out. Because attaching to either state will keep you in the three worlds where all states are impermanent, impure, not self, and ultimately unsatisfying. So, that was 1979. We have come to the end of the passage tonight, and we're going to dig right into suffering. If you want to suffer, come next week. Count on it, right? Oh, man. What an advertisement. Don't be late. Yeah, right. Okay, you will find the transference of merit in the back of your songbook. And my friend Imi Oi, Huang Huiyin in Malaysia, she sent something along the other day on Facebook. It was a mantra, a Sanskrit mantra that she had put to music. And it was, she said, we're sending this out to the souls of MH370, Malaysian Airlines, the missing plane. Imi is lives in KL, and you realize how quickly you forgot. There's an entire jetliner. No word yet. And all of those souls who whose families have no closure. She was reminding us that there's a need to keep those blessings moving, keep the thoughts running. So here's a chance to do that with dedication of merit. So wherever you would like to send your merit, that's your gift. So please do it. When we do it together with a concentrated thought, it gets really powerful. Thank you.
minds as one and radiant with light. Share the fruits of peace with hearts of goodness, luminous and bright. If people hear and see how hands and hearts can find in living unity, may their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward, may all who sorrow leave their grief and pain. May this boundless light break the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise.
Right, prepare for a slideshow, and we're going to have announcements after. Maybe we could have some announcements during, such as, I'm going to stand up and walk over to the podium, and if we could have the lights off over here, thank you. One of the announcements is that this coming Tuesday night, at Tiant's Tea Shop, we're going to have a Tea and Dharma program. And to pick up my microphone here. Starts at 7:30. Tiant's Tea Shop is over on 4th Street in Berkeley. And our topic is going to be kind of interesting. It's going to be talking about mindfulness, ink. The Alan, I need to find our BGA feed here. The mindfulness revolution, the mindfulness movement in America has become huge. It's worldwide, in fact. So I want to share a little bit about the Buddha's version of mindfulness, and talk about ways to bring it alive reliably, connecting it back to the Buddha's teaching. So it should be worthwhile, worth the price of admission. There's some of the world's finest tea will be poured. We're going to have music and there's a rumor that there'll be some puppets talking there, too. We need to, like, get that turned. There we go. Ah, thank you, thank you. Okay. We hope that the folks joining online can see our screen. As soon as the screen comes alive. Yes, by golly, it's working. Now, I just came back from Taiwan, as I mentioned, and did I show the food last week? You saw the food. All right, I'll show you again. All right. Bhikshuni Hung Ching in the center, my Dharma. Some people say Dharma brother, Dharma sister, Dharma brother, disciple of Master Shenhua, one of the three creators of the C Beta Tripitaka on a CD. And the Bhikshuni to the far left is Zhao Yun, Pasher, who is has invited us to go over to Taiwan to use her monastery to teach young people. She has a beautiful monastery and some very vigorous, powerful Buddhist women teaching there. So we're negotiating how that might happen. This is the Bikshuni, whose name is Quan Xian Basher. She's the daughter of Yang Yingfeng, who is this worthy man. Yang Yingfeng is right here. This was her father, a friend of Master Hua's, one of Taiwan's most highly regarded artists, the man on the left, your right. This gentleman to his left is Zhu Ming, his art student, who is, we're going to find out more in a minute. So Quan Xian Fasher is another one of these remarkable Buddhist nuns in Taiwan. If you're going to be a Mahayana Bikshuni, do it in Taiwan, because you have role models such as Bikshuni Zheng Yan of Ciji, Quan Xian of Juefeng Arts Institute, Shao Yun of Hua Fan University, the founder, and Hung Qing Basher. So these women who, in their career as Buddhist nuns, have changed the world and impacted Taiwan and the world around them in powerful ways. This is Wayne and his dad, Mr. Chun, Doug Powers, Annie, Mrs. Chun, some of our delegation. Franklin was not in this photograph. This is our organization, the Master Xuanhua Arts and Cultural Foundation, that did the hosted last year's piano concert. Gwyneth Chun played at the National Concert Hall. We were one of the co-host sponsors, and so we're doing cultural and artistic and educational activities in Taiwan and the world. This is Chancellor Xue Fujing, who was here during two Guanyin sessions ago last year. He is the Chancellor of National Taipei University, and has taken refuge, taken the Bodhisattva precepts, a serious cultivator of the way. Here we are in his office at National Taipei University. Has got, 10,000 students? Major school in Taiwan. Franklin, lecturing to the community, the students there at Taipei University. Here we are. Again, here's Franklin. This is our delegation to Taiwan this time, with Chancellor Xue. Here he is, there's his name. He's got Guanyin on his shelf. We traveled to two major themes of this trip. One was art. To everybody's delight and surprise, we discovered that arts and the Buddha Dharma interact. And the aesthetic, the idea of beauty in all its forms, beauty that pleases the ear like music, beauty that pleases the eye like visual arts, in this case, persimmons made of glass, by the Taihua Kiln Pottery Company, open a door. Westerners will come through this door. Asian folks come through this door. This is Mr. Liu, who is the head of the Taihua Arts Commune. I'm presenting my book here. This man is himself a potter. He says, I'm just a potter. He's really humble. He's way more than a potter. He's also a businessman who said to his fellow Taiwanese artists, he said, you're probably starving. If you're not starving, you're probably thinking, I'm going to give this up and go become an auto mechanic because I can't make a living with pots. He said, I want you to continue with your pottery. I'm going to give you a roof over your head and food to eat. Please come to where we are and create together. So artists did. He has a studio of maybe 50 artists who come and go and create things like this that you're seeing. They take traditional Chinese art and bring it forward into the 21st century in incredibly creative ways. Here's Bodhidharma. This is painters, potters, ceramicists, amazing stuff. that we, you can see this is creativity that hasn't existed before. They're making new forms, new ways, making this glaze happen requires putting the pot back in the kiln like 3-4 times, and you have to hold one color and bring the other color forward. And the artists are doing it right there in front of you. So we've been there 3 times now, probably go again. We've invited Mr. Liu to come to California to look at our situation and tell us how our arts community might come together in similar ways. The other thing he said was, we're doing Taiwan art, arts indigenous to Taiwan. It's Chinese culture, but it's grew in Taiwan. You don't have to go to China to market it. He's strongly holding the line, because everybody else says, go to China, get rich. He says, no, we're doing it here in Taiwan, thank you. You know, a lot of the stuff that comes out of China is not as developed as ours. And take a look, your eyes will tell you the same. Yeah. The wall, that's a painted wall behind her as the setting for this incredible Guanyin. Look at the glaze, how that was done. It's kind of magic. This is one of Taihua's patented colors. Getting this color on ceramics, very, very difficult. Doesn't exist anywhere else. They patented this, and they sent this one to the Pope. Pope Benedict got the big vase with this happy red on it. Okay, we spoke at night at a restaurant to 50 of Chancellor Xue's friends so they could hear the Dharma. A little bit challenging with all the restaurant noise coming through the curtain. It wasn't a great ambiance, but we made it work. And this is his son and his wife and his friends. And so when somebody who's a chancellor of a university is excited about Buddhism, he gets the word out. And we had 50 CEOs and educators who came to have dinner and then listen to the Buddha Dharma. Doug and I spoke. We went to Huafan. Huafan University is this university created by a Buddhist nun, an artist whose name is Xiao Yun, famous Taiwanese artist, left home in her later years. She said, I'm not going to make another monastery, I want to make a university. Because the Buddha was an educator. So these are the signs that welcomed us. Here we are meeting one of her two nun disciples. This is Renhua Fasher, and she's hosted us, and this is her her vice chancellor, Doug Powers. We're exchanging our various mementos that we brought along. We talked to, in their library, to a large number of students and faculty, including Sangha members. These are Master Xiaoyun, she's deceased, her two senior nun disciples who are carrying her vision forward into education in this school. It's a public university. They have 20,000 students who come and go every day and get their education there. The Sangha comes from Sri Lanka and Korea and Thailand, Burma. So quite a wonderful experience. Mr. Chun, with his old friends, he knew the founder. He was a supporter of Master Xiaoyun. I gave a talk at their in their lecture hall to 150 people, and I found out about it that I was going to give the talk 40 minutes before I gave the talk. I saw my picture on the poster, and that was when I discovered, oh, guess what? You're the speaker. Okay, right. So we faked that one, but had a connection with everybody all the same. Exchanging mementos. Things that if I had hair would make my hair gray. Good thing I shaved my head, otherwise you'd see. Okay, we went to National Taiwan University of the Arts, Guoli Taiwan Yishu Dashie. This is the premier school in Taiwan for preserving traditional cultural and contemporary arts. You see Gwyneth's picture here joined us as the first recipient of the Distinguished Humanitarian Award, Master Shrenhua. Distinguished Humanitarian Award. And we were greeted by 3 young musicians playing the Dizi, the Yangqin, and the Erhu. They made beautiful music, and everybody was applauding their welcoming performance. This is Chancellor Xie of the Arts University welcoming us. And he brought 3 professors forward to lecture. This professor is a calligrapher. To call him a calligrapher is kind of like saying Chopin was a composer, you know. Yes, he was, and he more than that. This professor talked about gilding images, 铁金, how you take gold leaf and put it on Buddha images, historically. Amazing, because the Chinese have perfected this over centuries and centuries. This professor talked about Guanyin Bodhisattva images throughout history. And she, interestingly enough, goes to Taihua, the pottery collective, every month and volunteers there, teaches. So that collective, that commune, is incredible in its influence. Everybody who went to Taihua came away inspired, because they were bringing the past and making it modern just the way we are doing, trying to do with the Buddha Dharma, keeping it alive and integrating it with the modern world. So here's the big, after the meeting at the Arts University, and exchanged our mementos under the kind gaze of Guo Fu, Sun Yat-sen, Sun Zhongshan, Xianxiang, right? The national, okay. His name was Feng Da, Liang Feng Da, the calligrapher. He wrote the Vajra Sutra. His bow is 108 of them. Want to see what they look like? That's the sutra. Gold ink, blue paper. Look at it. Right? That's his sutra. He's going to do 108 of them. His hand is up. He's held the brush so much he injured himself. He got a calligraphy injury. I think the only way you could get a calligraphy injury would be to drink the ink, right? Or hit yourself on the head with the ink stone or something like that. No, no, no. Too much painting. He's got a bandage on his hand. Look at this incredible creation. Seeing this makes everybody happy spontaneously. Look at the smiles on the faces. Just looking at this creation is just amazing. Here he is. He's repetitive stress from too many maobizi, right? You'd never think that a maobi could hurt yourself. Take a look. It's beautiful. The font is called Xiejingti, right? It's the sutra copying font that he's writing in. Oh, Lin Feng Da, his name is. Lin Feng Da. Professor Lin. What do you think, Jin Fo Shi, Guo De Qu Ma? Bu Cuo. Not bad. Beautiful, huh? Yeah, gold. Yeah, look. That's actually his, you know. There you go. Yeah. That's the sutra copying hand. Isn't that great? Look at the Guo, Xin. Beautiful. He's going to do 108 of those. So this is the welcome to the Arts University here, National Taiwan University of the Arts, it says down here, down there. We went to an exhibit, a painting exhibit, of the faculty of the Taiwan Arts University of the Arts and their counterpart in Tianjin, China. So it was a joint Taiwanese-Chinese art exhibit of the faculties of the schools, and it was here in this museum space. This is the curator of the museum, a wonderful professor who's got a great sense of humor and very round glasses, and you can see the quality of the art coming out of Taiwan. Incredible, incredibly beautiful. The Arts University also was given a factory, and they invited lots of art startups and crafts companies. This is one that works entirely in paper horses. And next was another kind of creative crafts and art. They were packing their stuff up for a show at Taipei Yilingyi, Taipei 101, the skyscraper in downtown. We went on to Dharma Drum, Fa Gu Shan, this is a lecture that I gave. And we discovered that they have a brand new campus. What do you suppose this is? What is it? A witch? It's a dormitory space, but it's a swimming pool. That's an Olympic swimming pool that they covered over and put a bunch of foam down. It's a sleeping space for when they do the Shui Lu Kong Fa Hui. This is a lay dormitory for men or women when they do the water, land, and air. Why? 10,000 people come. Check it out. Then they pull the covers off and you can practice your Australian crawl, your butterfly kick. This is just one of the halls where people come to recite, right? Everybody's got their sholu and their offering and then their sutra holder. Look at that. That's a scale, right? CTDB looks at this, we should weep, you know. Like 10,000, we have, 350, which is good. That's good. It's a start. We're not Taiwan, but when they do it in Taiwan, they do it big. This is a plaque about the new campus. This is interesting. They built this new campus, and Master Sheng Yan, who was the founder here, loves trees. So they dug up the trees carefully, put them aside, built the buildings, brought the trees back. So this tree is on his way back to being planted. This is the surrounding environment for the campus. This is a hall that holds 10,000 people. There we are. Elephant grass. You bet. That's the shulu, right? Elephant grass. That's not a cattail. That's elephant grass. Exactly. Take a bundle of that and tie a string around it, and you undo the string. Same with our bodies and minds. Exactly. Okay, 10,000 people. Can you dig it? Good grief. Okay, my turn. The time for a lecture at night. All the sangha, they filled this hall. Preserving human values in the high-tech world. This is getting set up. Everybody's ready. Lots of bhikshunis came. Professor Du Aming, Du Laoshi, introduced me, started talking. See, they had to put chairs in all the aisles out the door. Praise the Buddha. Have I preserved a balance between my work life and my domestic life? 我的工作和家庭生活有没有保持平衡? If your kids are awake, they're probably online. Article of New York Times. Doug Powers is actually singing. I've got proof here. He's singing. You think? Not really. Okay. How the Irish saved civilization. Then we had a tea party. This Professor Du went to Tiants. It's coming up this Tuesday. He liked it a lot. He went back to Fagu and said, let's do one. So they do it Chan Cha Wan Yin, right? So the nuns, the monks, both in training, make the tea and serve it to people sitting around. After 3 cups of tea, you feel mellow and balanced and centered and ready for a program. Then we talked about the topic that night at Dharma Drum was, how did you first make the resolve for Bodhi? In other words, when did you first meet the Dharma? What was, did you see somebody? Did you hear something? Was it a brother? Was it a monk you saw? Did you, experience some sort of misery and need a release from it? So what was it? And everybody spoke up. It was great to have people actually, the nuns were fearless. Yeah, I'll tell you what happened, It's really good. We went to the men's campus, the first building that Master Sheng Yan built. This is their Chan Hall. Very beautiful campus. Lots of green space, lots of air, and a view out one side that's just spectacular. We sat down together with Professor Du and the Vice Chancellor of the University, Dharma Masters, 2 Dharma Masters, and Professor Deng from Harvard, and talked about what it is that makes Dharma Realm Buddhist University different from their school and how we can mutually learn from each other. Oh, by the way, see this in the back? That's from Taihua. That's from our pottery collective. It's when these pieces show up everywhere. When I walked into this room, I smelled something very fragrant. It was this image of Bodhidharma. This is hinoki. hinoki desu, right? This is cedar, kuai mu, from Taiwan. A little image this big perfumes the entire room. Very beautiful. Cedar, so fragrant. So we had a long conversation and very fruitful. Then it was time to go. We left Dharma Drum, said goodbye to Professor Du, and we went to Zhuming Boguan. We're almost done here. Just another couple minutes and we'll be done. Zhuming is this phenomena. He's now in his 70s. He's a Taiwanese artist who had a vision and created out of wood, metal, stone, these monumental sculptures. He uses a chainsaw to rough them out. And this is, what, 30 feet tall? He did a whole series of Army, Navy, Air Force. They're faceless soldiers going through the suffering that soldiers know. He did a series called the Taiji series. This is pushing hands. You can see the scope of it. The energy of someone who's doing Tui Shou is in this sculpture. It doesn't quite touch the ground. You can see the energy flow back and forth in this chunk of stone. Incredibly powerful. And humorous, right? You feel like there's this couple under the umbrella sitting there in the sun watching you look at the sculpture. Very beautiful. Taiji. This is standing meditation. You're supposed to become like a tree. Here's the tree bark, right? It's just a chunk of rock or metal in this case, but you can see the alive. Very beautiful. Zhu Ming is a world-class artist. His museum is out right next door to Fagu, out in Jinshan, in that area, right on the coast of Taiwan, northern coast. And you have to walk a mile to see all of the sculptures because he put them outdoors, right? It's not in a museum with a roof. It's outdoors. That's the snack shop. And they're tired. See the little girl in her mama's arms here? These are life-size images, sleeping when you walk up. It's just so funny. Because they're like, you know, you go ahead, I'm tired, I've seen enough. Yeah. Businessmen under their umbrellas watching you. Here's the coast. This is just over, you walk to the edge of the museum and you look out. This is Zhu Ming, an elder, and he learned from Yang Yingfeng, Shifu's friend, who, okay, when you go to the Five Contemplations dining hall at CTDB, right, go to the big lunchroom, you know that big Guanyin with the thousand hands? Yang Yingfeng, that's his. If you look at our Earth Store Bodhisattva image and Medicine Buddha image, those are the ones, those are his. This is Zhu Ming's statue of his teacher. This is a wall hanging that he created. We didn't see these at night. I'm sure at night they're incredibly beautiful. Look at this chariot. It's taking off into the air. I'll bet when these are lit up, they're really special. Obasan. Thari. Then we stopped to see an old friend, Mingguang Pashi. This was the night of the election, and the poor Kuomintang did not do well. But this was his monastery was a polling place. Downtown Taipei. Went to visit old friends in Taichung. Here is Yogozhan Gojia. There he is. Yeah, he had a serious stroke and recovered. He's nearly completely recovered. These are friends from Taichung. This is Yu Guangzhong, the Chinese poet, Taiwanese poet. He's now in his late 80s. I first met him in 1969. We have a 45-year friendship going. And we visited him, he and his wife, Mimi, in Kaohsiung. He's a wonderful man. He introduced Western poetry to Taiwan, and he was, in the 60s, he was pioneering loosening up poetic forms. Very controversial back then, but now he's seen as, he's truly beloved by Taiwanese letters and arts. Wonderful old man. He was asking me about the Beatles. He's asking me about rock and roll and the blues. He's totally tuned into Western culture. Here is Mimi, his wife, and from their apartment in southern Taiwan, they keep in touch with police brutality and climate change. And she asked me all about genetically modified organisms. You know, in their 80s, their minds are totally awake and following everything. Great to meet them again. Dang Zhongwen Yu Jian Yingwen. Meeting English from the place of Chinese. Here we are at Liu Gui Six Turtles. This is our monastery in the south. They were having a Chan session. This is the next to last day in Taiwan. Here is, you can see our row of monks. This is Jin Wu Shi and Jin Pei Shi, myself. There's Hong Jiang Shi and the old faces from Liu Gui. These are friends that I made back in, this is the next generation. There's only a couple old timers here. Everybody else were kids when I got there, and now they're the parents. They've grown up and had their own kids. This is Du Jinsheng, Mr. Du from Qishan. Here is Zhang Jiaxiong, one of the old laymen from Qishan, pouring tea. He walks in the forest every day. He is looking fit and healthy. Boy, pay attention. He walks every day. That's why he, and this is his niece, his granddaughter, showing off her full lotus. She's so proud. Her t-shirt says, Qishan. That's their little town. She played ukulele for us and sang very well, getting some applause from her aunties. This is Zheng Tai Tai. She was our stalwart. Look at the, here she is right there, his granddaughter. Mrs. Zheng kept us alive when myself and Hong Zhangshi, when we were first there in Liu Gui. These are her daughters and her granddaughter. This is Mrs. Deng, Zheng Lijun, the executive director of the puppet troupe in Taiwan, the most famous puppet troupe, Wu Du Yao. Puppet and its double. And I gave her my jester puppet from Folk Manas here in Berkeley, and she made it come alive instantly. So she is the creator of my old monk puppet, and she's making a little novice to go with him. So we'll have the teaching coming down from the old monk down to the little novice. So. And we went back to Taipei Dasher in the last day. This is a documentary film director from public TV in Taiwan. He's done numerous award-winning documentaries, and he is making a movie of Dharma teachings from interviews that we gave. So we're looking forward. He got inspired. He says, I'm totally an atheist. I'm a scientist. He said, but the things I heard turned me on. He said, I called my son in Germany immediately. Got to hear this. He said, I think there's hope for me and my son having heard the way your teacher presents the Buddha Dharma. So that's it. Thank you for being so patient. We're running over time, and I promised I wouldn't do that again, but we'll try to get you out the door by 9:30 next week. All right, our announcements are the following. Tiance on Tuesday, and Wednesday is the awaken is not a public thing. Can you still go? It is public. And can people like... They can't sign up online. How do you do it?
Go to awakin.org.
Okay, awakin.org, says Tao. This is Wednesday night. I'm going to be presenting down at Nipun's parents' house for the Awaken Circle. This guy is being stubborn. It's damp. That's why it's not working. And if anybody wants to go down, this is our annual, there we go, our annual Christmas gathering down at in Santa Clara at the Metta's home. So if anybody has an interest in going, do it quick because it fills up. And once it fills up, their house is limited. So that's Wednesday night. Tuesday is Teance, Wednesday night, the Awakened Circle. We have, what else? What else is going on? Friday night lecture is done for the year, coming back in January. When do the sessions start? The Amitabha session begins this coming, not tomorrow, but the next Sunday. The next Sunday. I will be heading off to Down Under on that same day, on the 21st. So next Saturday, I'll definitely be here to be with everybody and to discover ways to explain suffering, right, in our text. All right, anything else to announce? Jinfo Shi Yu Mei Shoma. Oh, how did the meeting proceed today?
Yes, we had a meeting today.
Anything to announce?
Yeah.
We're late. Can we just do it quick? Can you do it?
I was going to say, if we're thinking of starting a family program here at Berkeley Monastery, kind of Great Strength 2.0.
Great Strength Academy 2.0. Next week, next Saturday, 5 o'clock, second meeting. Good. And we're back. Jin Hosher is back
from Australia, Malaysia. There he is
in the flesh. Look quick because he's about to succumb to jet lag. Anyway, Jin Hosher is back, so we'll be looking forward to him getting in the saddle and steering the ship down the road, mixing three metaphors in a single sentence. How about that? So he's got lots of stories about what it was like in Australia and Malaysia, and please don't hesitate to find out more. So glad you're back. And that's it. Let's transfer the merit. See you next week.
食道自禁,非道自退,在善而从,不善而改.
Said Sherfu. Bow in respect to the Venerable Master. Namo Da Fang Guang Fu Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Fu Pu San.